2021, and I literally just woke up, but I have been prompted to do this video, which I'm sensing in my spirit that it might be the last video for a little while. I know one thing that he wants me to share, and the rest is a surprise to me. I've been getting a lot of song messages and having an urgency in my spirit of time. So I don't question him when he's telling me to go and do something. So we are going to do a little Bible study on the Lord's Supper, which is actually a very powerful revelation and understanding he gave me about 10 years ago. It might have been longer, but it was during a time that I was kind of in the throes of battling fibromyalgia and seeking the Lord for healing, and he just led me to his word to study and meditate, and he gave me this powerful revelation, which I'm going to share with you, and I do believe it's going to change your life, and I don't say that lightly. So we're going to be in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, which is the foundational text of the Lord's Supper, but we're also going to be in the book of John, chapter 6, and we're also actually, I'm going to say we're going to begin there. But I think I'm going to read the passage that we're all familiar with from the Lord's Supper, that we hear when we go to church, or if you go or have gone to a Catholic church, then Mass usually reads this portion. So I'm going to read that portion first, and then we're going to the book of John. So this is 1 Corinthians 11, verse 24. And he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Verse 25. In the same way, also, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Okay, so that's what we usually hear at church. So now I'm going to John. And we're going to start in verse 22. Until he tells me to stop. Okay. So, John 6, 22. On the next day, the crowd that remained on the other side of the sea saw that there had been only one boat there, and that Jesus had not entered the boat with his disciples, but that his disciples had gone away alone. Other boats from Tiberias came near the place where they had eaten the bread after the Lord had given thanks. So when the crowd saw that Jesus was not there, nor his disciples, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum, seeking Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" Jesus answered them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, you are seeking me, not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for food that perishes, but for the food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you, for on him God the Father has set a seal." Then they said to him, "What must we do to be doing the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." So they said to him, Then what sign do you do that we may see and believe you? What work do you perform? Our fathers ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. Jesus said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but my Father gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. They said to him, sir, give us this bread always. Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst. But I said to you that you have seen me, and yet do not believe. All that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me I will never cast out. For I have come down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up on the last day. For this is the will of my Father, that everyone who looks on the Son and believes in him should have eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. So the Jews grumbled about him, because he said, I am the bread that came down from heaven. They said, is not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How does he now say, I have come down from heaven? Jesus answered them, do not grumble among yourselves. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up on the last day. It is written in the prophets, and they will all be taught by God. Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that anyone has seen the Father except he who is from God. He has seen the Father. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness and they died. This is the bread that comes down from heaven so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. The Jews then disputed among themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? So Jesus said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. As the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever feeds on me, he also will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like the bread the fathers ate and died. Whoever feeds on this bread will live forever. Jesus said these things in the synagogue as he taught at Capernaum. Okay, I'm going to stop right there. This is so rich. This is life right here. So there is a passage that I'm going to come back to. But first, we are going to 1 Corinthians 11, beginning at verse 17. And we're going to go all the way through verse 33. So I hope the lighting is okay. I'm sorry, I'm not really thinking about that right now. But so 1 Corinthians 11, verse 17. But in the following instructions, I do not commend you, because when you come together, it is not for the better, but for the worse. For in the first place, when you come together as a church, I hear that there are divisions among you. And I believe it in part, for there must be factions among you in order that those who are genuine among you may be recognized. When you come together, it is not the Lord's Supper that you eat. For in eating, each one goes ahead with his own meal. One goes hungry, another gets drunk. What? Do do you not have houses to eat and drink in? Or do you despise the church of God and humiliate those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I commend you in this? No, I will not. For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever therefore eats the bread and drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many of you are weak and ill, and some have died. But if we judged ourselves truly, we would not be judged. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are disciplined, so that we may not be condemned along with the world. So then, my brothers, when you come together to eat, wait for one another. If anyone is hungry, let him eat at home, so that when you come together, it will not be for judgment. About the other things, I will give directions when I come." Okay, so here Paul is addressing the church in Corinth. And he is giving a directive and an instruction on the Lord's Supper, but he's also giving a stern warning, which many of us know about, and there's a lot in here, and we're going to break it down so that we can gain understanding, because if this is your first time reading this, it can sound a little intimidating, and make you feel apprehensive about taking the Lord's Supper. But he's gonna explain for us. So let's go back to verse 20. When you come together, it is not the Lord's Supper that you eat. For in eating, one goes ahead with his own meal. One goes hungry, another gets drunk. So he's addressing those who don't understand what they're doing when they're taking the Lord's Supper. They're just eating it because it's food. They don't understand the spiritual provision that it is, or the physical provision that it is, because it is both. So he's correcting them. He's admonishing them for doing that. And then he goes into the instruction from the Lord, which he stated, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you." This is verse 23. "That the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Okay, so the Lord said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." So let's go back to John 6. Where are you, John? Okay. Okay. Okay, let's begin in Yes, 35. I am the bread. Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst. Okay, let's go to verse 41. So the Jews grumbled about him because he said, I am the bread of life that came down from heaven. Okay, let's go down to verse 47. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness and they died. This is the bread that comes down from heaven so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. Okay, so as we know, the Lord died on the cross, and his body was broken. Go back to actually, it is that verse, but there's different translations. Let me just double check on that, because my translation is different. Right. So King James Version says, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. So if we think about different traditions in different churches, so some churches have done like the wafers, the little circle wafers, and the little cups of grape juice. Other churches, for example, I think the Catholic Church has like a loaf of bread, and they tear pieces off of the bread and give it to the congregants, and then they have a cup of juice for everyone to drink from. So, but this is my body which is broken for you. So we know that the Lord was crucified. His body was literally broken for us. And now we're going to go to one passage of scripture that I have literally lived off of, which is Isaiah 53. Who has believed what he has heard from us, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form of majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and as one from whom men hid their faces. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted, but he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. I'm going to keep reading, actually, but we are going to come back to this section. And we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away, and as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living? Stricken for my people, stricken for the transgression of my people, and they made his grave with the wicked, and a rich man in his death, Although he had done no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth, yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him. He has put him to grief when his soul makes an offering for guilt. He shall see his offspring, he shall prolong his days. The will of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Out of the anguish of his soul he shall see and be satisfied. By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant, make many to be accounted righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore I will divide him a portion with the many, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and makes intercession for the transgressors. That is the work of the cross of Jesus Christ. That is what he has done for us. It's overwhelming. So going back to John, the bread of life, the Lord Jesus is the bread of life. I'm in the wrong chapter. Chapter 6. Okay, verse 47. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness, and they died. This is the bread that comes down from heaven, so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. I'm going to keep reading. The Jews then disputed among themselves, saying, "How can this man give us his flesh to eat?" So Jesus said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. As the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever feeds on me, he will also live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like the bread the fathers ate and died. Whoever feeds on this bread will live forever." Okay, so Jesus is telling us plainly that there is not only a spiritual understanding and truth and life. receiving him as the bread of life. But there is a physical connection, as we know, because of the Lord's Supper, which is a physical demonstration of believing what he has done. Taking the bread, which he has very clearly and plainly stated for us that is his body that was broken for us, and receiving it as the life that we need is life transforming. And I'm about to share with you the revelation that he gave me. Let's go back to Isaiah 53. Verse 4. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. Remember, at the cross, he bore the sin of humanity. Every tear that every human being has ever cried, he has borne it. Every sin that every human being has or will ever commit, he has borne it. He carried our griefs, he carried our sorrows. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was pierced physically for our transgressions. Transgressions are sins that we commit against others. He was crushed for our iniquities. He was crushed. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. He was chastised as he was going to the cross. He was laughed at. He was spat upon. He was mocked for our peace. And with his wounds, we are healed. Other translations say, by his stripes we are healed. His lashes I've had different translations Bibles, so sometimes I can't remember if I'm reading from the same scripture, because I think it's this passage, lashes. You know, he was whipped by his stripes. We are healed. His body being broken and being the literal bread of life is saying that when we take I'm actually going to go to a different translation, because I think this is going to help, especially if you guys have different translations. Okay, I'm going to go to King James. Let's see. We are in Isaiah. Isaiah 53, King James. So I'm on Bible Gateway, if you're curious. If you don't have a literal Bible, that is a good online Bible. Yes. So King James, verse 4. Okay, so this is Isaiah 53, verse 4. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. The Lord took sin upon himself, but he also took sickness and disease upon himself. When we come to the Lord and partake of the Lord's Supper, when we take the bread, we are coming in faith, believing that whatever sickness and disease you are battling or whatever physical struggles you have, that He already took it for you. So when you take the bread, you are proclaiming his death. Let's go back to 11, 1 Corinthians 11. Verse 23, for I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. This is powerful. Because he did this before he went to the cross. He already knew what he was doing and what he was going to do for humanity. Now, Paul is referencing the Last Supper. When Jesus first shared communion with his disciples. Okay, we're going to go there. Now, as you know, Matthew, Mark, and Luke are known as the Synoptic Gospels, and different accounts of much of the same I want to say stories, but what happened. So I'm going to go to okay, we'll do all of them. Okay, so let's start in Matthew. Yes, I remember, Lord, I remember. Okay, so Matthew 26, in verse 17, the Passover with the disciples. Now on the first day of the unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus, saying, where will you have us prepare for you to eat the Passover? Okay, I'm sorry, let's drop down to verse 26. Now as they were eating, Jesus took bread, and after blessing it, broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink. Drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink again of this fruit of the wine, of this fruit of the vine, until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." Wow, that just made me really happy. Okay, so now we're going to Mark chapter 14, verse 22. As they were eating, he took bread, and after blessing it, broke it and gave it to them and said, "Take, this is my body." And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank of it. And he said to them, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I say to you, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." Okay, now we're going to Luke. Chapter 22, verse 14. And when the hour came, he reclined at table, and the apostles with him. And he said to them, "I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he said, "Take this and divide it among yourselves. For I tell you that from now on, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." And he took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And likewise the cup after they had eaten, saying, "This cup is poured out for you. This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. But behold, the hand of him who betrays me is with me on the table. For the Son of Man goes as it has been determined, but woe to the man by whom he is betrayed." Okay. So, highlight this because, as you know, when you read Matthew, Mark, and Luke, there's always a little more. There's always another layer of understanding. As we see in this one, in Luke, he says, verse 20, "And likewise the cup after they had eaten, saying, 'This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood.'" The new covenant, which is what we are under. We are under the new covenant. Okay, so we're going back to 1 Corinthians 11, verse 24. "And when they had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" When we take the bread and we remember him, we remember that his body was broken with our pain, with our sickness, with our disease. So when we are taking the bread, we are literally giving him what he has already taken for us at the cross. Lord, thank you for taking this fibromyalgia at the cross. I know you bore it for me. I know that by your stripes I am healed. I believe and I receive the health and the strength that you purchased for me at the cross through your body, which was broken for me. In the same way, also, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. As often as you do it. Now in church, traditional church settings, every church is different. Some churches do it every week, some churches do it once a month. But as often as you do it, you can do it every day. You know, because it is you proclaiming the Lord's death. It is you communing in communion with him. I've had seasons where I've taken the Lord's Supper like meals, like 3 times a day. It's very personal, but so as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and the blood of the Lord. An unworthy manner means you don't understand what you are doing. You don't understand the power and the seriousness of taking communion, which is what he was addressing in the church. They were just eating it like it was food, and they had no reverence for what it represented and what it actually, that it is a living, I want to say sacrament. It was a living testament to what he has done for us. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. Let a person examine himself. When we come to the table, we come with everything that we have. We come with our brokenness, we come with sin, we come with our pain and suffering. That is to examine yourself when you come before him. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. Discerning the body, that is what we just talked about. Discerning that the body was broken for me. He was broken for my healing. He was broken for your healing. His body was broken for your sickness, for your disease, for your physical pain. He literally took all of that at the cross. Every disease that's ever been known to man, including the one that is running rampant right now, he already bore it. He bore everything. So when we come to him and we take the bread, we are literally saying, thank you for taking this for me. I receive the healing that you already gave me. I acknowledge that it is finished. And also, for anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body, eats and drinks judgment on himself. There is a distinction between the bread and the wine. And I'm going to get into the wine in just a minute. That is why many of you are weak and ill, and some have died. But if we judged ourselves truly, we would not be judged. That's powerful. If we judged ourselves truly, we would not be judged. Why? Because he bore judgment. As partakers, as children under the new covenant, judgment is not our portion anymore. He has already taken judgment upon himself. And when we are in Christ, we are delivered from that judgment. And proclaiming the Lord's death is literally stating that judgment fell on him. And we are simply coming to acknowledge and thank him for it. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are disciplined so that we may not be condemned along with the world. When we are judged by the Lord, again, when we come under the shadow of his wings, when we come under the new covenant of what he has done, what he has given himself for, so that we may not be condemned along with the world. So then, brothers, when you come together to eat, wait for one another. If one is hungry, let him eat at home, so that when you come together, it will not be for judgment. Again, those that don't understand the power of communion and what they're actually doing are incurring that judgment because they're not discerning that that this is serious, that this is a spiritual acknowledgement. So if you're doing it carelessly, you are not discerning the body. You are not discerning how his body was broken and how his blood was shed. You are just receiving it blindly, which is why it's really important that we have this understanding in the church. So let's go back to verse 25. In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Okay. So there's a distinction between the bread and the cup. Now we're going to gain some understanding about the cup. Going back to Isaiah 53. Okay, bear with me one sec, please. I'm actually coming back to Luke. Luke 22, verse 20. And likewise the cup after they had eaten, saying, "This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood." So his blood was shed for the sin of mankind. Isaiah 53, verse 10. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him. He has put him to grief when his soul makes an offering for guilt. He bore guilt. He bore condemnation. He bore judgment for mankind. That's why this is so powerful when you understand to be in Christ is to be set free and delivered from judgment, that because he bore it, he bore sin, he bore judgment, he bore death. So when we take the cup and we come to him with our sin, confessing our sin, thanking him for his forgiveness. It is understanding that we are forgiven for whatever we have done, whatever we do, whatever we will do. He has borne it at the cross. His blood was shed for the sin, the condemnation, and the death of man. So when you take the cup and you remember, Lord, you bore this sin, you bore this guilt, you bore this shame, you bore this condemnation, you bore the sorrow that I have, you bore the pain that I've endured in my life, you bore the rejection that I've been through, you bore it all for me. You understand? Sorry. It changes your life. So, okay, let's go back to 1 Corinthians 11, 24. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Every time you come to the Lord in communion, whether you do it alone or you do it with others, this is your thank you for what he's done for you. I hope this has blessed you. It has blessed me for so long, and I'm so grateful for the revelation he gave me, and that I've shared it. I've shared it before, but I'm actually sharing it now on YouTube. I think that is all for the Lord's Supper. As far as everything else, please continue to be where he's calling you to be. Time is so short. Things are moving so quickly, and I pray that you are wherever he needs you to be, that you are brave and bold, and that you trust him every step of the way. Remember, we walk by faith, not by sight. Especially now, we need to really understand he's got us. He's got us. He's taking care of us. When we are yielded and ready to go at a moment's notice, he's gonna make a way. So trust him. I'm still here. If you need anything, please feel free to message me via email or social media. Actually, I'm only on Instagram, so if you're going to message me on Instagram or on social media, it would be Instagram or email. I hope you're doing well. Continue to persevere. Continue to remember your true identity. Continue to walk in love.